हेलो एवरीवन, कैसे हो आप लोग? माई सेल्फ चेतन गर्ग, आई एम मास्टर टीचर हेयर एट वेदांतु। आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू आवर आरएमओ फ्लैशबैक सीरीज। इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग क्वेश्चन नंबर 5th एंड 6th ऑफ, दैट इज लास्ट टू क्वेश्चन ऑफ ईयर 1997, राइट? बोथ ऑफ दीज क्वेश्चन वर वेरी इजी। वन क्वेश्चन इज फ्रॉम परम्यूटेशन एंड कॉम्बिनेशन, एंड इन फैक्ट अ वेरी सिंपल, वेरी बेसिक एप्लीकेशन ऑफ परम्यूटेशन एंड कॉम्बिनेशन। एंड अदर क्वेश्चन इज मिक्सचर ऑफ इनइक्वालिटीज, ज्योमेट्रिकल इनइक्वालिटीज, और यू कैन से नंबर थ्योरी, राइट? सो बिफोर डिस्कसिंग दीज टू क्वेश्चन, आई जस्ट गिव यू वन इन्फॉर्मेशन दैट करंटली हेयर एट वेदांतु वी आर रनिंग प्री आरएमओ, आरएमओ एंड आईएनएमओ बैचेस। फॉर मोर डिटेल्स ऑन प्री आरएमओ बैचेस, यू कैन विजिट आवर वेबसाइट olympia.vedantu.com. हेयर वी हैव प्रोवाइडेड ईच एंड एवरी इन्फॉर्मेशन रिगार्डिंग प्री आरएमओ बैचेस, राइट? एंड दोज हु हैव ऑलरेडी क्लियर प्री आरएमओ और आरएमओ, they should simply mail me these details, their name, their class, their contact number, address, along with the proof that you have already cleared either of these exams on this email ID, chetan.garg@vedantu.com. Even if you have any other academic achievement, that is, if you have cleared NTSC or any other competitive exam, you should also mail me on this email ID, right? Those who have already cleared pre-RMO, we will simply enroll you to RMO batches. And those who have already cleared RMO, we will simply enroll you to INMO batches, right? Both these batches are completely free of cost. You do not need to pay even a single rupee to enroll in these batches, right? So let's start our session. This is question number 5th of year 1997. And if you have not tried this question, I request you to please take 5-10 minutes. Try this first. If you are still not able to solve this question, you can come anytime to watch this solution again, right? So I'll start with the solution. This question is basically based on geometrical inequalities. The question states that if x, y and z are three distinct real positive numbers, right? X, y, z are three distinct real positive numbers, real numbers. They are not basically natural numbers. They can be any real positive numbers, right? We need to determine this with proof whether or not the three real numbers, this, this and this, can be the lengths of the sides of a triangle, right? So we need to prove whether this will represent the length of sides of a triangle or not, right? So let's assume, without loss of generality, we can assume that since these numbers are distinct, so one of them will be greatest and one of them will be smallest, right? So let's assume that x is nothing but greater than y, which in turn is greater than z, right? And also assume, let these three numbers represent the sides of a triangle, right? We have assumed that these three will represent the sides of a triangle, right? And we will try to find out whether they can represent or not. If we have come towards a contradiction, then we can say that these will not represent the sides of a triangle. If we come to a truth, if we come to a fact, then we will say that these three will represent the sides of a triangle, right? And if these three positive numbers are the sides of a triangle, then they must satisfy the triangular inequality, which states that sum of any two sides is always greater than the third, right? So let's assume the smallest two sides. If x is greater than y, which is greater than z, then the largest side will be given by the third one, and modulus of that will actually be equal to x upon z minus z upon x, right? So this will be the greatest side. This should be less than what? The sum of other two. So by taking mod, it will become x upon y minus y upon x, as this value will be lesser, this will be greater, right? Plus here y upon z will be greater, so simply mod of this will be equal to y upon z minus z upon y, right? So if we can prove that this holds, if this is true, then these three will represent the sides of a triangle. If by continuing with this inequality, if we come up to a contradiction, then we can say that these three cannot represent the sides of a triangle, right? So let's try to solve. Let's take the LCM. LCM will be simply xz, right? Here it will be x square minus z square, which we can write x minus z into x plus z, right? So that should be less than. All right, let's take these two together. So it will be x minus z upon y plus, let's take these two together. So LCM will be xz, y will be common, and we will be left with x minus z, All right. Since x is greater than z, according to our generality, right? So x minus z will get cancelled out, right? And the inequality will not change because x will be greater than x is greater than z. So what we are left with, x plus z upon xz, that should be less than 1 upon y, which is in terms plus y upon xz, right? So this will further imply, let's cross multiply the things, xy plus zy less than xz plus y square, right? So take y square here and zy there. What we will get, will y will be common, so it will be x minus y, that should be less than z will be common, x minus y, right? And again, since x was greater than y, so we can cancel out x minus y and the inequality will not change. So this will imply that y is less than z. But what we have assumed, that y is greater than z. So this, here comes a contradiction. Okay. And since this is a contradicting statement, so we can say that these three cannot represent the sides of a triangle, right? So according to this contradiction, we cannot say that these three will represent the sides of a triangle, right? So once again, I'll sum up the solution. Without loss of generality, we have assumed that this is the pattern. We can assume any pattern. We can assume x is less than y, which is less than z. Since these three real numbers are distinct, positive real numbers, right? Since they are distinct, so there must be one pattern, right? We have assumed that x is greater than y, which is greater than z. And after that, let's assume that these three numbers represent the sides of a triangle, right? And we have then find out what will be the greatest side. This should be the greatest side because x is greater than y, which is in terms greater than z, right? So x upon z will be the largest, right? And z upon x will be the smallest. So this thing will be the largest side. So if it represents the side of a triangle, then the triangular inequality must hold, which states that sum of any two smaller side is always greater than the largest one, right? So humne wo wali inequality ko aage continue kiya, and then we came up at a contradiction that initially we have assumed that y is greater than z, and we have solved that y is less than z. So since this is a contradiction, we can say that these three cannot represent the sides of a triangle, right? So that was a very easy question. This question is based only on the fact that sum of any two sides of a triangle is always greater than the third, right? So let's proceed to the next question. This is question number 6, or in fact last question of year 1997. This question is very easy. This is basically simple application of PNC, permutation and combination, right? The question says that find the number of unordered pairs AB, that is the pairs AB and BA are considered to be same. Okay, this is what unordered means, right? Find the number of unordered pairs of the subsets of an n element set X, right? Which satisfy the conditions. There are two conditions. First is A should not be equal to B, all right? That is the first subset that should not be equal to the other subset. And the union of these two subsets, that is A union B, that should be equal to the set X, right? For example, isne kuch examples nahi hai. Let's assume X is a set which has four elements A, B, C, D. Then A, B, B, C, D, right? This is one of the example of A and B. Here A is clearly not equal to B, and their union is also equal to the set X, right? We can say this, are some of the admissible pairs, right? So what we need to find, the total number of such unordered pairs, right? All right. So first try to understand, if X is, let's say, a set of any n elements, right? So in how many cases A will be equal to B, right? Which also satisfies A union B, that should be equal to the set X, right? If A union B is equal to set X, that means every element of set X that should either be present in set A, or it should be present in set B, or should be present in both, right? So at least every element should be present in at least one set A and B, right? So when will be A equals to B? When both are equals to X, right? This is the only possibility, when both will be equal and A union B will be equal to X, right? Because if we skip even a single element from A, and since it is equal to B, then that particular element will also be absent in B. So their union cannot be equal to X, right? So to satisfy this, we will have only one case when both a and b are equals to x, right? Now let's assume x has n elements, 1 2 3, all right, not 1 2 3, maybe any n elements, right? X has n elements, right? So let's take one element. One element will have three options. It can be placed in only A, it can be placed in only B, or it can be placed in only C. In both A and B. So every element of X will have three options. Since there are n elements, so 3 into 3 into 3, this will become 3 power n, right? Right, so these are the total number of subsets in which every element will be either present in A or in B or in B, or both in A and B, right? So this will simply imply A union B will be equal to X. But here A can be equal to X, right? That will be one of the case. So let's subtract that particular case when both are equal, right? Now, since we have excluded that both are equal, so we are left with this many cases, right? But here each pair will give us two. Basically, this is the number of ordered solution, but we are interested in only unordered, right? Here, basically, this will be one solution and it's vice versa, that is B, C, D, A, B. This will be another solution. So these are counted as two solution in this, but we need to count them as only one solution because we are interested only in unordered pairs, right? So the total number of solutions will be simply half of it, right? So the answer will be nothing but 3 power n minus 1 upon 2, right? Because we are interested only in unordered pairs, right? So as you can see that this is the very simple question of permutation and combination, right? Right, I hope you understood this question. So that's it from today's session. Today we have discussed last two questions of year 1997, right? In the next lecture, we will be discussing next two questions, first two questions of year 1998. And before ending the session, I'll just give you one more information that I have already given at the start of the session, that currently we are running pre-RMO and RMO and INMO batches here at Vedantu. Those who have already cleared pre-RMO or RMO or even NTSC, they should mail me these details on this email ID, chetan.gar@vedantu.com. We will try to enroll you in RMO and INMO batches, right? And these batches are completely free of cost. You do not need to pay even a single rupee to enroll in these batches, right? So see you in the next session. Till then, take a very good care of yourself. Thank you. Bye-bye.